Hi everyone. Today we'll be talking about some of the neoplastic syndromes that occasionally feature in the PACES Station 5 and Station 2 stations. So this is an overview. We'll be talking about Mann syndrome, von Hippel-Lindau, Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, as well as carcinoid syndrome. Of the four, Mann syndrome is probably the one that comes out most frequently and often in the PACES Station 5 context. So let's talk about Mann syndrome. So there's Mann 1, 2A, and 2B. The way I remember it is for Mann 1, it's 3Ps. So it's pituitary, parathyroid, as well as pancreatic neoplasms. For 2A, it's 2Ps and 1M, so M for medullary. So it's parathyroid, PHEO, and thyroid medullary. And for 2B, it's 1P and 2Ms. So the second M can stand for mucosal neuromas or Marfanoid body habitus. So for Mann 1, 2A, and 2B, unfortunately, it's something that has to be committed to memory. But beyond the details of each of the Mann syndromes, I think it's important to talk about how they can feature in the PACES Station 5 exam. So I would say that the commoner manifestations would be that related to pheochromocytoma, as well as in some instances, patients who have hyperparathyroidism, as in Mann 1 or 2A, with manifestations of hypercalcemia. So this would probably be the commoner too. However, of note, the signs that you may find the patient may pertain to previous surgery. So in the neck region, you can have surgery relating to thyroid or parathyroid surgery. And in the abdominal region, this can be surgery pertaining to the pancreas, as well as pheochromocytoma. So let's talk a bit about pheochromocytoma. So pheochromocytoma has a classic triad of headaches, sweating, and palpitations or tachycardia, as well as associated features of hypertension and sometimes tremors. So this can be an approach to any of the symptoms listed here. It is also important to know the associated syndromes with pheochromocytoma. So Mann 2 syndromes, as mentioned earlier. The other two syndromes would be that of von Hippel-Lindau as well as neurofibromatosis type 1. And hence, if you come across a patient with the suggestive triad, it is then important to look for other features suggestive of these syndromes. In terms of investigations for pheochromocytoma, this would involve urinary as well as plasma, metanephrines, and catecholamines, and subsequently targeted cross-sectional imaging to elucidate where the lesion is. In terms of management, it is important to upfront give alpha blockade with phenoxybenzamine, followed by beta blockage. This is important because if the patient is beta blocked with unbridled alpha action happening, this can cause the patient to collapse. And surgery is the mainstay after this has been achieved and the patient has been stabilized. Next is von Hippel-Lindau syndrome. This is an autosomal dominant condition with some of the relevant neoplasms that can be associated with it, including pheochromocytoma, as mentioned, clear cell RCC, as well as other neuroendocrine tumors of the pancreas. There are some other associated neoplasms, such as retinal hemangioblastomas, neoplasms of the epididymis of broad ligaments. But I would say for the PACES exam, it's probably worthwhile focusing on features of pheo. Clear cell RCC may present with features such as hematuria and less commonly neuroendocrine tumors of the pancreas. Management-wise, it's mainly targeted at the involved tumors as well as the relevant genetic counseling. Next is Peutz-Jeghers syndrome. This is once again an autosomal dominant disorder with key features of hamartomatous polyps and mucocutaneous hyperpigmentation. This can be found in the lips, the perioral regions, as well as the soles of the hands and feet. Patients may typically present with either symptomatic anemia from occult bleeding or frank gastrointestinal bleeding. And investigations-wise, we include that of endoscopy as well as the relevant genetic testing. So this is the classic periorbital hyperpigmentation that we see in Peutz-Jeghers syndrome, taken off the internet. The last condition I'll be talking about is that of carcinoid syndrome. This is not a inherited hereditary neoplastic syndrome, but I think it's worthwhile talking about it. I would say perhaps it could come out in either the station 2 or station 5. So in carcinoid, what happens is that there's excessive secretion of hormonal products like serotonin, prostaglandin, as well as histamine, that then results in manifestations such as flushing, diarrhea, and bronchospasm. So these are approaches that may, let's say flushing may not be one that we are very accustomed and familiar with. So it's important to consider coming up with a systematic approach for an approach such as flushing. But yes, in other approaches such as someone with shortness of breath or diarrhea, carcinoid in the appropriate context is important to consider. So usually for carcinoid syndrome, these are usually small bowel neuroendocrine tumors, but they can also occur in their primary form in the stomach as well as in the lung too. So by the time one gets full-blown carcinoid syndrome with the hormonal manifestations, there usually is liver metastasis. Hence, it would be important to also examine the abdomen for any hepatomegaly and to suggest imaging for the abdomen as well. Investigations will include 24-hour urine collection of 5 HIAA and diagnostic imaging with the use of radio-labeled somatostatin analogs. Treatment-wise would be in consult with the oncologist, either with hormonal-based therapy or consideration of surgery. Yep, so this is just a short session talking about some of these neoplastic syndromes. Hope that you found it helpful.